What are NoSQL databases? What needs they serve? And what are the databases that are worth learning? Well, the best way to explore NoSQL databases by contrasting NoSQL databases with SQL databases. You see, SQL bases normalize data. SQL databases structure data using tables. And tables have a schema. Every row is the same kind of data. And because SQL bases are targeted at the transaction use case, they're structured to follow the ACID rules that we covered earlier. However, transactions are not the only possible use case. There are plenty of other use cases where a database is needed. Sometimes scale or speed constraints are such that the solution is to selectively break the rules, so to speak. It's worth noting here that NoSQL initially meant not SQL. It has now been retconned, so to speak, at least for some databases, as not only SQL, as those databases also support SQL queries. However, NoSQL databases invariably make a trade-off. They sacrifice one or more aspects of the ACID rules or normalization to perform better in a specific area or to meet a specific use case. And that's the best angle from which to understand the differences between NoSQL and SQL databases. So let's explore together which use case the databases were designed to meet, which ACID or normalization rules they break, which performance metrics they gain by doing so, and what specific weaknesses they have. It's worth noting here that NoSQL databases are not the monolithic, homogeneous group that SQL databases are. That means it's impossible to cover every single NoSQL database here. So I'm going to cover my three favorite databases in depth, namely Redis, MongoDB, and DynamoDB, and hand out some honorable mentions and tools to watch out for. So first, Redis and its clones. An important point here. When I'm talking about Redis, I'm referring to the concept and the technology of Redis, not the specific implementation that the Redis company is trying to make less open source. So, what is Redis? Redis is an in-memory key-value database, which does away with normalization and sacrifices durability for speed. Why is durability sacrificed? Well, as data is stored in memory, there are some cases where data can be lost. For example, if power is cut and Redis is configured only to use memory. Now, it's worth mentioning that there are use cases where this is perfectly fine. For example, if using Redis as a cache. And even if Redis is configured to write to disk, you could lose a minute or so of data. But using RAM as storage allows Redis to offer speeds that go far beyond what SQL databases can offer by several orders of magnitude. This is why Redis is used by Uber, by Airbnb, by Twitter, by Shopify, to name just a few. The technology is solid and it's mature. Another point I like about Redis is its ability to run Lua scripts on the database, which allows you to add a level of logic within the query that SQL queries don't support. On the other hand, since everything happens in memory, Redis is much more expensive for the same amount of data. But Redis is so rich and versatile that to me, it's an essential tool. It can be used as a cache, which allows us to combine the strengths of an SQL database with those of Redis. But there's so much more to Redis, with so many exciting data structures that it's hard to cover it all in this video, but I've covered it elsewhere. And then we have DynamoDB by AWS. In a sense, DynamoDB is the opposite of Redis. Where Redis aims to respond quickly for a small volume of data, DynamoDB aims to respond at a constant speed with a very large volume of data. It's a fully serverless solution with no fixed costs that can scale down to almost nothing and up to very big applications. To achieve this scaling ability, DynamoDB sacrifices both consistency and normalization. In fact, the best practice in DynamoDB is to store all the application's data in one single table. There's a very good video on the subject by the solutions designer, which I'll link to in the description or up here. It's fascinating, but it's also completely destabilizing. And to me, that's the most difficult part of developing with DynamoDB, of understanding how best to use it. DynamoDB's main drawback is that it can only be deployed on AWS, but that hasn't stopped Netflix or Medium from adopting the solution. And somewhere in between, we have MongoDB. MongoDB organizes its data by collections of JSON documents, which are stored as binary blobs. In a sense, Mongo is the closest of the three to an SQL type solution. As the name suggests, MongoDB aims to be able to scale. It does this by sacrificing normalization. In MongoDB, you don't split an object's data over rows contained in different tables. Instead, MongoDB allows you to create documents with nested information. For example, a user's different addresses or the lines of an order. This means that retrieving the data naturally requires fewer joins, which increases the database's speed. However, a collection can contain documents that follow different schemas. That means that although MongoDB does support ACID transactions, it doesn't encourage normalization. And because MongoDB is schemaless, it's best used when combined with an ORM. I used to recommend Mongoose, but today I probably use Prisma. As you can see, there isn't an SQL standard on one hand and a NoSQL standard on the other. The NoSQL group is kind of a catch-all that contains very different solutions and use cases. It's worth mentioning also Elasticsearch, which is search-oriented, as the name suggests, or Neo4j, which is graph-oriented, or CockroachDB, CouchDB, or Cassandra, each of which are optimized for a specific use case. So which should you choose to create a project with or to learn? First, whatever database you choose, you'll also need a cache, which means learning Redis or a similar solution. But what other database should you master? Well, that depends on what you're building. Obviously, if you have exponential growth, if you're building a social network that's built on a graph, or if you need real-time interactions, a specialized NoSQL database may well be the ideal solution. But if you're experiencing exponential growth, you probably shouldn't be basing your technological choices on YouTube videos. But outside of these edge cases, and let's be honest, even within those edge cases, a developer today should really understand the basics of using SQL, because SQL is a proven widespread solution that works in most use cases. It may not always be optimal for a given use case, but it's a safe bet. Not an exciting solution. It's not fresh, it's not new, but it's reliable. It gets the job done, especially if you understand exactly what it brings to the table, so to speak. But that also means having a deep understanding of ACID transactions, what they are, what they mean, which I've explained here in this video, and normalization, which I've explained in this video. So I'll see you there.